revelation that we are at chapter 5 now. It is the third week we are sharing on Revelation chapter 5, verse 8.
Even in heaven, we will continue to grow. Okay?
as regard to rewards, of course, there are different measures of rewards, right? As the Bible says, those who teach people this and kingdom will be this in the kingdom. So this Peter, great, may be great in the kingdom of God. Maybe Matthew, right? Your best supporting scripture is Matthew chapter 5, there, 1950. So this is some supporting evidence about the least and great in the kingdom of God. Alright? And you want to talk about the first place that you found in Corinthians chapter 12. And you can find in Ephesians chapter 4. All these supporting scriptures are there. Alright? So we need to. I'm saying you are worthy. They take the scroll and open the seal because he was slain. Jesus laid down his life. And with your blood, you purchase God's people from every tribe, nation, and people and nation. You make them king, the kingdom of priests, and they will be with you on the. So we can see, and what we can learn from here is that in order to save soul, many years we started this church from $1.40. Alright? And when we came here, we spent $100,000. Alright? So it's by God's grace. So we need money, and we need time, we need sacrifice. So you want to win souls, you must lay down your life. And Jesus laid down his life. There's no shortcut. There's no shortcut to win your family to Jesus. You have to demonstrate love. There is no shortcut to win souls because you have to pay a very high price. Alright, and for us, I think our group, we went to visit Jonathan, right, and pray for him for almost a year already. And recently, I think I never visited someone so often before in my entire life. Every week we visit one time, two times, for over a period of 6 months or more. And the doctor told them, say, he will die. But then we pray, then he's alive. Right, and then he's in church, probably he's not in church. And the mother of God said, I'm baptized upstairs. And then the sister also come back to the Lord. So we pay some price because in labor, we work hard, evangelism door to door, and in our own problem to contact. And then and we labor and we work very hard just to pray for the whole church, right? We have a prayer group. And we pray. So, these are examples of laboring. I've been laboring my sibling. I even got the whole family, siblings, seven brothers and sisters, say only 1.5. Almost 30 years I've been sharing the gospel with my eldest brother, who's still not saved. But out of seven, I think four, maybe in the Lord, still the remaining three. We are all two eldest brothers and one second younger sister. Alright, so you have to pay a high price. You need to pray for them, showing love and all that, labor. So, every God's presence that he has to lay down his life not to be the world. So, similarly, you have to lay down your life. You have to sacrifice. You have to pay right. That's God's way. And I have been a soul winner for many years. I mean, when I was a missionary, I won many souls, but it's not easy. Okay, you have to labor with God. Partners with God as the Spirit leads you, alright, especially your family. Yeah? Okay, so here he says that you were slain, and with your blood, so he says the blood, right, purchased for God's person. With your blood means God's love, in the cross. And from every tribe, and you make them, so in order to bring them to be a kingdom of prayer, you need to disciple them. That's why we emphasize a lot of discipleship. Okay, Thursday we have cell group, the book of Acts. Friday we have cell group, the book of Corinthians. Saturday, my son and daughter teaching the book of John. Right? And then Sunday, collecting the topical study. And the devotional group we did the book of Psalm. And yesterday, I started the book of Isaiah and the youth. We used the book of Nehemiah. It's an excellent book, Isaiah, and now I'm doing the book of Revelation. So we believe a lot of Bible study, and then we have the disciple group. We have two disciple group then, Yathalaya one group, and Angeline, and Gideon, and my daughter in another group. And then Sunday, I leave another group, and Kava into another group. So we have many groups of discipleship. Because the Bible says, go and make disciples of all the nations. Alright? And Jethro told Moses, the three things you need to tell the people. First thing is the law, teach them the word. The second thing, show them how to lead the lifestyle. And the third thing is the ministry you involved. So, a true believer, a true disciple of Jesus Christ, he will give up everything. The Bible says you cannot be my disciples unless you give up everything. Then come and follow me, right? So the view means put the kingdom's priority above everything. But the mystery is that when you give up everything, you actually can more than double of everything that you need. Alright? So you say, where's the word of support? It's in Mark chapter 10, verse 29 to 31, talks about this. Alright? You will be blessed at the present age as well as eternally. So you have to pay a high price. And then we have to make them the kingdom of priests, meaning we have to disciple them, to nurture them so that they are spiritually strong, so that they can reign with God. Alright? So they have to have a certain level of spiritual maturity by its time. But very few churches are doing discipleship. Alright? The Bible did not call us to win just new converts. The Bible says we are called to be disciples. And we have to put in the effort in doing so. And doing so is not so easy. You know, for Brother Jimmy and Carol, for us to knock at their door. And then today, praise God, they came to church. They come to church. And you know, not easy. You know why? We have been trying very hard. Every week, almost every week, we go out for many, many years. And we had the youth, so many, we brought hundreds, no? But then, really stay only 30, right? Or 30 or more. And but they stay with us and then we disciple them, right? So, and then, so it's not easy, alright? But if you don't start, you got nothing. But at least you start, you can see the fruits, alright? So, Angeline is the first, right? And then, Ingsu is the second last. We have one more Andrew on Saturday, right? So, he was saved last December, alright? And then we recently we got Andrew, alright? So the Lord is blessing the new ones, alright? So we have to pay a high price. There's no shortcut. Okay. Alright, the new song you can read there. It's a new and distinct way and new one in nature. Okay, let's move on. And he is worthy to take the scroll. And Jesus is deemed worthy to take the scroll and open the seal because of his sacrificial death. And worthy because he laid down his life to purchase the souls of the world. And Christ's worthiness was based on his great deed for act of redemption. Though the Bible says it is not the hearers of the word are righteous, it is the doers of the word. So we must do, okay, we must do more. As the leader is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will lead us. Alright? Is our growth is the work of the Holy Spirit. If we are strong, it is the work of the Holy Spirit. And of course the part that you is the response to the word of the Holy Spirit. Or even, okay. And he was worthy precisely because he was slain. His sacrificial death was his means to purchase the blood. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. Right? He was slain, right? So, 10:45. If you study the scriptures carefully out of the four gospels, the book of Mark is the earliest writing. And then the various gospel writers copy from Mark, right? And then they expanded. Okay, the Mark 10:45, this is the thematic verse, and this is the central, but this is the most important verse in the entire book of Mark. And after this verse, 10:45, you go back and read. Jesus never talks about, never straight his public ministry. This is the last. Why he said this is significant? Because this is a climax. Alright? It starts from Revelation to Peter that Jesus is a Jesus called them together. You know that those who are regarded as ruler of the Gentiles lord it over them. Okay, we are not to control people's life. Eh? And not so with you. He said, whoever wants to be great among you must be your servant. Okay? To enrich others, eh? You to enrich others. Servant leadership or servant king. Eh? In order to be king, you have to be a servant first. But whoever wants to be first must be the slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to give his life a ransom to many. So you can see, as I mentioned many times, maybe those who have may heard me for the first time is look at 46. Why is there a connection between verse 45 to verse 46? Verse 45 talks about giving your life a ransom to many, and 46 talks about the blind man of Timas and was healed by Jesus. And the blind man heard about Jesus, so he asked for Jesus to requested that Jesus to heal him. Right? But when he heard it was Jesus on his right, he began to shout, "Jesus, have mercy on me." And the disciple rebuked him, but he shouted all the more. When someone discourages you from being healed by Jesus, you must shout anymore. When someone discourages you to go to church, you must go to church no more. When someone say anything discourage you about the kingdom of God, you should do more, just like this blind man. And then Jesus met up with him, stopped and called him, and Jesus asked him, "What do you want?" He said, "I want to see." Alright? You want to see, yeah? So what's the connection? Okay, the implication is, and then what Jesus healed him, right? For his faith, right? And God is telling us, do you see what I'm trying to tell you? To be great in the kingdom of God, to open the spiritual life, you must sacrifice greatly. Do you see that? Okay, there is no shortcut to become great in the kingdom of God. You must pay a very high price. Then you are worthy like the Lord, and he will reveal his secret of his way more and more to give you greatness. Okay, the context of open your eye, open the seal means revelation. So in other words, if you lay down your body, your life, lay down means you sacrifice, you give 100% of your effort, your sacrifice, and everything, the resources and so on, God will reveal more and more to you. Okay, that is God's way. In order for God to reveal you more and more, you must sacrifice more and more. Alright? So there is no shortcut. You know why there is no shortcut? You might have been a Christian for many years. You know, look at the life of Apostle Paul. He did not have time to sleep, no food, no water, no drink, and so on. Almost stoned to death and all that. And he has great graduation. Alright? There's no shortcut. You might be the entire Bible. I was started as a missionary since 1990 and planted. Second church that helped another pastor plant two churches. This is the third church I'm doing. There is no shortcut. There's no shortcut. This is God's way, because when you lay down your life, it shows your great love. Jesus said there's no greater than to lay down your life for your friends, right? And Jesus called you friend. Because it's no longer question, because whatever he knows from Father, he will reveal to you. Alright, so there is no shortcut. Alright? So, okay, give you the background. Then James and John, okay, this is a connection. The son of Zebedee came to Jesus. He said, "We want you to do for us whatever we ask." So Jesus said, "What do you want me to do?" He replied, "Let one of us sit at your right hand and at your left hand and in glory," right? And Jesus said, "You don't know what you're asking. Can you drink a cup I drink or be baptized with the baptism I baptize with?" He said, "We can." But he answered, Jesus said, "You will drink the cup I drink and be baptized with the baptism I am with. But to sit at my right the hand is not for me to decide, right? But these things are given to those who need and repeat." So what's the meaning here? Greatness. Okay, so connect with just all the verse, right? One of the criteria is you must go through great suffering. Okay, baptism is compared to talking about his death. Okay, Jesus there, man. Okay, in the book of Acts chapter 12, James, the brother of John, was put to death by King Herod Agrippa. Alright? So just evidence which shows that he did suffer, he martyred. He was martyred, right, by Herod King Agrippa. Okay, John was banished to the island of Patmos, he wrote the book of Revelation, so that's what we did, yeah. And then, of course, he was put in a, he was somewhat spoiled, but he was not struck, he was not scorched there, and he was, after that, he was banished to the island of Patmos. And John suffered. He's the only one who did not suffer a martyrdom, so-called, the guy of old age. So you can see that the price to be great in the kingdom of God is suffering, but not for foolishness. Alright, if you have 1 million, you give the Lord all 1 million, that is suffering. Alright, that is wisdom. Okay, but poverty is a curse. Alright, okay, as you can see, yeah, but wisdom is the resources that God gives us, they are supposed to be given back to God. Alright, and then He multiplies the resources. Alright. And as I say, you give up everything at the end of the day, you have done more of everything. Okay, like the king of Job, right? Alright. Okay, and Mark did not write anything further about the ministry, right? And Mark 10:45 is the climax of the ministry. Let us move on. Go say, Jesus, your faith has healed you. Immediately, he received his sight and followed Jesus, not the Lord. How much will you sacrifice for God will depend on your faith? And hence respond to him accordingly for his glory by partnering with him to expand his eternity. We all have the same 24 hours, but we are born differently, we are gifted differently, but we can respond from our heart. A lot of Christians, they are not growing. Reason they might even respond to God. They don't respond to the Holy Spirit. They want to do things their own way. Alright? So, but we are given a choice. We have to decide, okay, whether to be ourselves to be to the Lord or not. Alright? So, like this blind man, he said, Jesus, heal me. He said, your faith has healed you. Alright? So, it's very important. You only want life to live. Give your best. Alright? And nothing in the world can compare with the things about before the thing was just to be. Alright? So, the kingdom of God is above all. Above all the worldly stuff. Okay, God's kingdom must always be first. Because why? For that reason he died. So he did not die for a mansion. He did not die for anything else. He only died for his soul. That is the main thing in life. Human soul. Alright? Is most precious. Nothing is more precious than human souls. And that's why we must go all out for Jesus. Because his heartbeat is, you hear God, have you heard of Jesus' heartbeat? Some say that you hear Jesus' heartbeat, right? His heartbeat is people, right? It's always about people, alright? So we should go around to raise a soul for Jesus. We need to be proven to be found worthy in the sight of God, such as we lay down a line for his soul wisely according to the pattern and his example. Jesus is our model. Okay, the chase of God is through his blood, and Jesus has redeem people from all nations, and need to pay a high price to win the souls for the Lord, eh? To make them kingdom of priests to reign with him. The blessed are the meek, okay, and they will inherit the earth. So, okay, let's go to doxology, right? Okay, then I look. I heard the voice of many angels, numbering thousands and ten thousands. Alright, so there are many thousands. A lot of why they say worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength, honor and glory and grace. How many are there, right? Seven, right? Sevenfold or doxology and seven blessing attributes. What are the first attribute? Okay, let's look at the okay. Okay, let's look at the first one, power. The power signifies Jesus' omnipotence and authority over all creation. You know why Jesus has seven attributes? Because, you know, what is the, how to arrive at this seven attributes? How the principle is that how did he come to have these seven attributes? You know, right? was the price?
His life.
Huh?
His life.
He laid down his life. Okay, you want to have these seven attributes in a sense of the communicable attributes of God, not the incommunicable attributes like the all waters. But it's the communicable attributes that you can receive, you have to pay a price. What's the price? Get down your life. Okay, the first one, okay, let me explain. Power. If you want to have authority, you need to lay down your life. Okay, spiritual authority, that means spiritual maturity. Alright? Jesus' omnipotence and authority over all creation. He undertakes his ability to accomplish his will and exert control over things. The Bible says in John says that God poured out his spirit beyond limit to his son, and he also called him poured without limit to you. And then he put him in charge of everything. So God, when you are spiritually mature, God put you in charge of many things. Okay, that's authority, that's power. But of course, the omnipotence, you don't have all powerful, but you have certain level of authority. Second thing, might. Often translated as strength. The ability to overcome any obstacle and his prevailing power in action. He reflects his capacity to exercise his plan and purpose effectively. Alright, and God will give you the strength. Alright, and God will not only give you the authority, he will give you the power, the strength to do the work that he called you to do. Alright, spiritual work, signs and wonders. Alright, and bring salvations. In the book of Acts, talk about signs and wonders and thousands of saved. Right? So, to John, signs and wonders, his mother came to know the Lord and baptized, and his sister came back to the Lord. This calls for signs and wonders and wisdom. Wisdom, well, the Bible in 1 Corinthians 2:9, right? God prepared his mature wisdom to those who love him. To those who prepare for those who love him. You love him, he will show you his wisdom. That's called revelation, right? This refers to Jesus' omniscience and perfect understanding. He heightens his ability to make the best decision and profound insight in all matters. That's why I say the one who is spiritual is subject to no man's judgment. Right? He can understand almost everything. Alright? So you can only come to this state only when you pay a high price. There's no shortcut. Alright? The more you sacrifice for God at all, the more he reveals to you. Okay, that's God's way. Alright? There's no other way, because what do you think? That Jesus did not spare his disciples, his apostles, and almost all that, right, of the martyr there. Do you think he will spare you? No, you truly want to be a disciple. You really want to go out for his kingdom. You really want to grow and understand his work. You have to pay a very high price. You need to diligently study the work, go and do the work. I tell you, I've been doing bachelors for so many years. You know, although somehow you have to decide which one is the right one. Okay, somehow this one you can really learn as the Lord show you, right, along the path, and then how to go about it. You will grow as you work. The Holy Spirit is a partner. He will show you. He will lead you and you will grow. Alright? And I thank God for this gift. I started off as an evangelist, right, and leading many souls to the Lord. And then became a church planter. Right now, today I'm a church planter, yeah? Alright? Church planter. Okay, so you can see that the wisdom is revealed, right? Through your pay a price. And the other one, you can contract the term well, right? You say you have well, right? What does the well mean? Abundance and fullness of the good things that God belong to Christ. Huh? And of course, the blessing of God comes from material and spiritual riches on earth that we can use it for God. These are all forms of well due to his sacrificial and redemptive work. He emphasized the completeness and sufficiency of Christ in all aspects, making him worthy of all praise and adoration. So, of course, God will bring in the wealth, not only through you, to your family, both material and spiritual, especially spiritual, that is the maturity, right? The word of God, the wisdom of God. Okay? And last week we talked about the sevenfold ministry of the Holy Spirit, right? And give you all spirit of counsel, power, and so on. And okay, the sarcophobic scripture, Peter said we have left everything to follow you. And Jesus replied, no one who has left home or brother, sister, mother, father, mother, or field for the gospel will fail to receive what? As much, 100 times better than the honor in this present age. Homes, brother, sister, mother, children, field, your job, along with persecution, is yet to come. So, there will be manifold blessing. Yeah, as you give everything to God, in return, God bless you, your family, with everything, and believe that the Lord will bless the church. Alright? So, this is what we call a paradox. Okay? That means the opposite, right? And it's a kingdom reversal, the system, alright? Of course, everyone God blesses, we space. Right now, we have two units, we are praying for more, right? So that when we combine, we have enough space. Right? But anyway, not in a hurry. There's a lot of blessings. In this time, he makes all things beautiful. And now we use what the Lord has given us. Because we cannot have anything unless God gives it to us. Alright? So you can see that, but many are first will be last, and many who are last will be first. Okay, one example is the John the Baptist was created by Herod Antipas, right? And where was he put? He was put in the dungeon of the palace. And then John died. He was last in this world. King Herod, Herod Antipas, okay, the created king. He was first in the king, in the kingdom, in the world kingdom. But he died. Without Jesus, he would have, right? But John the Baptist, although he died, but he was first in the kingdom, he was there. Alright? So in the world, we forgo many, many things, we are nobody, but in the kingdom, we are somebody. But those people who are somebody in this world but do not know Jesus, and they are nowhere in the kingdom. Alright? So talking about talking about status and other things, the one is not important. The important thing is the quality, the substance that we have. You know, the title. Okay, title is not important. Okay, title is just give you the opportunity to do the work. But more important thing is your quality. Who you are is more important than anything else. Okay, honor. Okay, what is honor? It acknowledged his supreme worthiness and his reverence, he was honored, and honored as the God exalted to the highest position, and he was glory, right? It goes beyond honor, signifying praise and adoration. Glory is often associated with the visible manifestation of God's presence and majesty. Alright, so we will be honored by God. Okay, we will manifest His glory, right? And then we have wealth, spiritual wealth especially. We have wisdom, we have authority and power, and we have blessing. Expressions of gratitude and worship directed towards Jesus. And knowledge of His goodness and desire for His continued favor and happiness. And blessing is in the context of offering thanks and prayer. The worthiness of Jesus to receive all forms of praise and adoration emphasize his ultimate authority and his profound impact of his sacrifice. So all these attributes, God will honor us when we honor him. Okay, 1 Samuel 2:30, right? You will honor God, God will honor you. Right? And you'll be exalted, you'll co-reign in him, you'll be the kingdom of priests, kingly priests. Okay, this attitude. Okay, this verse correctly underscores the supreme worthiness of Jesus to receive all his attributes because of his sacrificial death, victory over sins and death. So same thing, you can receive these qualities, attributes more and more in increasing measure. The more you lay down your life, the more you will be honored, the more the Lord will bless you. Okay, especially spiritual wealth. Okay? So the Apostle John described a visions where countless angels along with the living creatures and elders. They are all proclaiming the worthiness of the Lamb. The scene emphasizes the universal recognition of Jesus' sacrifice and the supreme authority and honor. The greatest The sacrifice for the kingdom, the greatest the revelations, the higher the authority to be empowered to you and due to God's even greater spiritual maturity, because you laid down your life. And in your relationship with one another, have the same mindset as Jesus, who being in the very nature of God, did not consider himself equal with God. Rather, he made himself nothing, taking his very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in the appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to them, even there on the cross, and therefore God exalted him to the highest place, and gave him the name which is above every name, but at the name of Jesus, every knee bound, every tongue confess, and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus is the Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Okay, therefore, my friends, you have always been, and not only in my presence, but much more in my absence. For it is God who works in you, and to act according to fulfill his good purpose. So there is not one say forever sinner. And one say forever sinner is a wrong doctrine. Okay, you must work out your salvation with fear and trembling. You have a freedom of will. You can still become a Christian and live the law. You can still be like an apostle, like Judah is here. And he was designated as an apostle. But the Bible says he died and go to hell. This is some doom of prediction. Alright? He was an apostle, but he went to hell. He went to hell. Okay? That one is in the scripture. Okay? And now it is God who makes us both of us. I like this verse. Okay? It is God who makes us stand firm in Christ before he anoints us. So today we are here and we are firm not because he made us. Right? You say what? He made us. Not our strength. He made us. The other thing is what? May the Lord make your love increase. Not that we have the love of Lord increase. He made us. He made our love, God's love increase in us and overflow for each other. Alright? And strengthen our heart so that we can be a greatest life holy. Okay, so it is all the Lord. The Lord make us firm. The Lord make our love grow. Okay, it's not we can increase our love or may no. It's God is doing the work. It causes an increase of God's love in us so that we can love others more. It is God, not us. Alright? Then I heard every creature in heaven and earth, and under the earth in the sea, and all in there saying to him who sits on the throne and the Lamb, be praise and glory, glory, power forever and ever. This verse is part of the visions where all the creation acknowledge the worship God and Lamb. And he emphasized the universal recognition of God's sovereignty and the honor due to him. The imagery of every creature joining in praise highlights the completeness and unity of worship in heaven. And the four living creatures, the angel, say Amen, and the elders bow down and worship. Christ's triumphal sacrifice has transformed men and women from every part of the universe into priests and a servant. This is what we must do, make disciples of one nation. Lay down our line, transform men and women from every part of the world into the priestly kings and reign with God forever and ever. That is what God wants us to do. The Savior is for this purpose. When everything is destroyed, and this is the ultimate purpose, to be with him forever and reign with him. Okay, so this is the God ultimate purpose. Let's go to chapter 6. I watched, I can finish, see the time, eh? I watched as the Lamb opened the first of the seven seals. Then I heard one of them and said, come. And look, and there before me was a white horse. His rider holding a bow. But there was no arrow. Do you realize that? There was no arrow. Alright? So in the sense that there was peace, there was no war, so-called, like, in a sense of the word. It was only a bow, and it was given a crown. And he wrote as a conqueror and man of conquest. Who is this person? Look at a different view. But this person is Antichrist. Okay, he's Antichrist. And this is talking about, because chapter 3, yeah, the church of Israel, right? Went up. Okay, chapter 4, chapter 5 about sins in heaven. And then talking about these revelations of the great the 7 years of great tribulation, we start from here. Okay? We start here. We haven't entered the great tribulation yet because the church is not raptured. Huh? The verse is the opening of the seventh seal, which is symbolic that lead to the end times. The rider on the white horse is often interpreted as a figure of conquer and conquest. Okay, the rider and the bow is a weapon of war, indicating that the rider is prepared for battle. Though no arrow, possibly a period of the 3.5 years of peace treaty. Okay, the Antichrist come out to make the 7 year peace treaty. First three and a half years is peace, right? And if you go by the second half is the third world war. Okay, the third world war is recorded in Revelation 16, right? The crown signifies authority and victory, suggesting that the rider has been given power to conquer. God allows it. God, the Holy Spirit is withdrawn, restrained. Conquest. The rider's mission is to conquer, which aligns with the theme the four horsemen, beginning with different forms of judgment and calamity upon the earth. Okay, this identity is a false messiah, Antichrist. The first seal revealed the white horse. It symbolic the peace which exists initially upon the earth during the first part of the Great Tribulation period. Possibly. Okay, alright. So you can see that the Middle East, they are going to have a war, right? Soon they're going to have a war, right? And this one will fulfill Psalm 83 and Ezekiel 38 verse 5. Okay, where the Persian, the Iran will beat the war, right? This corresponds to the first 3.5 years of the 7 years of the tribulation. The first represents the nations. That one is another view. I can skip that one and go on to. Okay, skip the 2 and 2 to slide. Verse 3. When the Lamb opened the second seal, I heard the living creature. Then another one came up. This is a great horse. Very hard. It was given power to take peace on the earth and make people kill each other. Alright? What does this represent? The symbolic of war and bloodshed. The appearance of this horn signified conflict and violence. The rider is granted the authority to remove peace on the earth, leading to widespread violence and chaos. The last sword, it means a conflict and destruction, emphasizing the scale of violence and will ensue. Alright, after the peace treaties, after the 3.5 years, we followed by the great tribulation of 3.5 years, they call it the church of trouble. Alright, the second half of the 3.5 years, the church of trouble. Alright, and the passage is part of a larger region. Okay, so each horseman represents different, okay, this one we already mentioned, right? The red horse, okay, let's talk about war, right? Let's go on to verse 5. When the Lamb opened the third seal, I heard the living seed come, and before there was a black horse, and it was the rider, a pair of scales on his hand. The black horse represents famine and economic hardship. The imagery suggests that the basic necessity will be in short supply, and the people will struggle to afford even the most essential food. The following verse review the high cost of wheat. Wheat is more quality than barley. Barley is cheap. Further emphasize the theme of scarcity. Then I heard a sound of a voice among the living saying, 2 pounds of wheat for the day with denarius and 6 pounds of barley for the day. So that means you can buy more with barley than the wheat, right? This wheat and do not damage the oil or the wine. The luxury foods remain intact, but it's only the basic necessity that's a problem. The poor has a problem. Okay, the verse, what is the poor? It symbolizes, the black horse symbolizes famine. Okay, a quart or wheat for the denarius. A denarius was a day's wage for the laborer. This indicates that the day work would only be enough to buy a small amount of wheat, highlighting severe scarcity and inflation. The 3 quarts of barley and the denarius barley was considered less desirable than grain, and so 3 quarts of barley could be bought for the same price, suggesting that the people will turn to a cheaper and less vicious food by the body during the famine. I mean, the poor will suffer. Alright? Okay, let's move on to. Okay, in end times, wheat and barley are sold at highly inflated prices, indicating a time of scarcity and economic hardship. And this suggests that people will struggle to afford even the most basic necessities. So in the end time, there will be great trouble, great economic hardship. Alright? So let's move on. Let's go on and say, do not harm. Okay, the slide, do not harm the oil and the wine. It suggests the basic staples of the wheat and wheat will be scarce. But this could also mean that there's luxury items like oil and wine will remain unaffected. This could imply a disparity where the wealthy continue to have access to luxury goods while the poor will suffer from the lack of basic necessity. This passage emphasizes the economic hardship and social inequality that will accompany the famine during the end times. Okay? So there will be a great, great trouble. Okay? Alright? So this one you'll see, especially you can see more detail in subsequent chapters. When the land opened the fourth seal, and I heard a voice, okay, say, come. I looked, there before him was a pure horse, and his rider was named Death, and he was holding close behind him. And they were given power over the fall of the earth to kill by war, by sword, famine, and plague, and by the wild beasts of the earth. Okay, the pure horse symbolizes death and decay. The rider named Death represents death itself, bringing mortality to humanity. Okay, the Hades is a Greek, okay, it's the underworld, and Hades, okay, where people die, we go to Hades. Let's go to the power of the earth. This indicates a significant but not total impact, affecting a quarter of the world's population, and they will die by four methods: by war, famine, disease, and wild beast. So one quarter of the world population will die. You can see it's a great tribulation period. And so you can see the disease, right? So now the disease COVID is nothing. Right, even the monkey pox is all nothing compared to the end time disease which are coming. Right? In the book of Revelation chapter 9, okay, the scorpion, the sting, and you won't die. Okay, that's one of the demonic pox. Okay, the investment is part of the larger vision, conveying themes for judgment. And in that, the four horsemen collectively represent various forms of suffering and calamity that we see. The final judgment, where Jesus Christ will come back and judge the nations. Alright, at the Armageddon. Okay. So when he heard the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of those who had been slain, recall the work and the testimony they have maintained. So these are the martyr, people martyred during the end times and they died for Christ. And many believe these are the Jewish evangelists. Alright, and they will die. Right? And then they go to every part of the world to share the gospel and they are persecuted. Okay, let's look at the soul under the altar. The soul under the altar are those martyrs who have been killed for their faith. The altar symbolizes a place of sacrifice indicating that these individuals sacrifice their lives for the belief in God. And these martyrs were killed because they upheld the word of God and maintained their testimony. This highlights their steadfast faith and commitment, and even in the face of persecution and death. The significant in assured believers that the sacrifices are recognized and valued by God. Okay, that is the cause of discipleship. The cause of discipleship and the power of the hope of divine justice for those who suffer by their faith. So, we have to pay for the price. We are assembly of God, and my understanding of the scriptures that true believers, that the parable of the virgins, out of the five, out of ten, only five make it. The other five will make it. Still talking about Christians who miss the rapture. Okay, we based on the parable of the virgin, at least 50% will miss the rapture. Alright? Only the other five. Right? We talk about recent seven churches, only two churches are good. Smyrna and Philippi. They are small churches. They are representative of Singapore churches and all the world else. Right? So, and many will miss the rapture, and they will have to go through the great tribulations. Alright? So we are looking forward to the rapture, but before that, we have to pay the price, the cost of discipleship. Alright? So it's very important that you start now. Don't miss the rapture. Start, be serious with God, and go and make disciples of all nations. Alright? Come and join ourselves by the study of discipleship. And you have time, you can go with us to do evangelism. Or you can do one. All together will be good. Go at home. And all time is also fun, yeah? Alright? And okay, and try to wrap up because the MC, yeah. Okay, let's. Okay, this is all God's plan, yeah? They are told to rest a little longer. The martyrs are told to rest a little longer because again the God's plan is still unfolding. There are still a divine timetable and the full number of martyrs has not come in. And Jesus Christ has not. So they have to wait for Jesus because God is unfolding his plan, eternal plan. And we continue to save souls until such time the enough souls are wrapped in and then rapture will take place. And of course, in the end time, God has his divine plan. So there's a specific number. And more believers will be martyred before God's plan is ultimately fulfilled. Okay, let's go to deeper. Okay, here basically is talking about God is looking at your giving, God is looking at how much it costs you, not the amount. The rich men, they give out of their abundance. Okay, they have we have $1,000, they give $100, they give $10 is nothing. If you have $2, you give $2, you give more than the one who give $10. Because why? God is looking at your heart. He's looking at how much it costs you. Alright? So how much it costs you? Like Cain and Abel, the next example. Cain gave to God, and he just gives some of the vegetables. Alright? But Abel was the shepherd, right? One is a farmer. And he did the first thing, the firstborn. Okay? So he did the best. Okay, after the brother of jealousy killed him, right? So, and God was pleased with the sacrifice of Abel, but he was not pleased with the sacrifice of Cain. Right? So, the Bible again and again is how much it costs you that matters. You know how much you give, how much it costs you. Alright? Okay, let's move on now. I try to become a kiddish. Okay, how long, right? The word, how long, sovereign Lord, and holy and true until the just inheritance of the earth. So God's time, right? So we open the sixth seal, okay, very quickly. The sixth seal, and there was a great earthquake. The sun turned black like a set cloth, made of gold hand, and the whole moon turned blood red. And the star in the sky fell to the earth. And sweet dropped from a fig and shaken to a storming. The heaven receded like a straw and being rolled up, and every mountain and island shone in the sun. Revelation shall describe the opening of the sixth seal, the earthquake, and so on. Let's go on to these verses, often interpreted symbolic, okay, a significant upheaval in the judgment. It suggests a profound disturbance in the natural order, around the falling star. And the receding of the sky indicate cosmic chaos. The removal of mountains and islands signify the complete transformations of the earth landscape, emphasizing the totality of the changes brought by the judgments of God. And these events are part of a series of judgments that lead up to the final establishments of God's kingdom. God had to remove these nations, remove the nations in order to usher in the new nation. Is a learning kingdom, and they serve and underscore the severity and inevitability of divine judgment and the ultimate shrine of God's will. Alright? Okay, and for the great day, then the kings of the earth, the princes, the general, and the rich, the mighty, and everyone who will stay and free. Okay, and they call to the mountain and the rock and fall on us. Okay, you see on that. for the great day of the Arahant has come, and who can withstand it? Okay, no one is exempt from the divine wrath, right? In this case, there's a lot of kings there. This reflects the overwhelming fear and realization of their helplessness before God. So the God judgment will be upon them. Okay, last part. The passage serves as a warning about the consequences of ignoring God's call for repentance and ultimate accountability everyone must face. So I've completed my sharing up to chapter 6. Basically, what the book of Revelation here is telling us is that we must lay down our life in order, okay, in order for God to bless you, right? To grow, and then for God to bless you, bless your family, and bless the world around you. And if you ignore, okay, you are accountable to God. Okay, especially the people that work with God, believe Jesus, you are accountable to God. So everything you do, good or bad, okay, you have to stand before God to give an account. Alright? So this morning, our afternoon message is to encourage us to join with God, join with the church in partnership in fulfilling the Great Commissions, to lay down our line in order to win the soul and make them disciples, co-workers with Jesus, and eventually to glory with God as the kingdom of priests or his eternal kingdom. Alright, today I hear you say, God, I want to be serious. Today I want to lay down my life, okay, and to fulfill your Great Commissions. Alright? And God, okay,